Hear us, O Lord, have mercy on us, for we have sinned against you. To you, Redeemer, on your throne of glory.
Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me and deny himself, take up his cross and follow me." I remember last Ash Wednesday and thinking how strange it was for me that year. I was between jobs, just got back from Japan, and looking forward to the Sunday when I was going to be inducted as mission area leader here of Dufferin Cloyd. I remember thinking, I can't let the beginning of Lent slip by without marking it somehow. So I snuck in and I took the Ash Wednesday service in Llanfair before I'd been licensed. A lot has changed since that day, a year ago, but I'm still sat here thinking this year's Ash Wednesday is going to be a bit weird. The only difference is this year it's not just me thinking it. We can't gather and mark our heads with ash as we normally would, but we must still mark the beginning of our journey through Lent. It is a day of obligation for all Christians. So let's just take a minute to think about it, shall we? Firstly, what is Ash Wednesday and what is this ash all about? Well, Ash Wednesday marks the beginning of our Lenten season, 46 days before we reach Easter. It's 40 days, the six Sundays of the season aren't counted, of retreading those well-worn paths that lead inevitably to the suffering of Calvary and the joy of an empty tomb. To mark the beginning of our journey, we traditionally mark our heads with ash. But have you ever wondered where the ash comes from? The ash is made from the palm crosses of the year before, ceremoniously burnt and the ash collected in preparation to begin our journey through Lent. This emphasizes the circular nature of our journey. Our Lenten journey is one we follow anew each year, where we follow Jesus's journey as he turns his face to Jerusalem and his ultimate purpose. We follow that journey for 40 days, retelling and reliving the story each year, the same path, and yet each journey is different. If you were to read Mark's Gospel from beginning to end, it's not very long, so well worth doing one afternoon, you might discover a clever narrative device at the end which gives an insight into the Christian life. If you take the last few verses of the shorter ending, the longer ending was added some centuries later, we end with the discovery of the empty tomb and a figure who tells the disciples not to be afraid, that the Jesus that they are looking for has been raised and goes ahead of them to Galilee, where they will see him again. Rewind now to the beginning of Mark's Gospel and start reading again. There, in the very first chapter, in verse 14, you will find yourself in Galilee once more as Jesus comes to proclaim the good news. The journey is circular. The Christian life is circular. Every time we meet the risen Christ, we are sent back to the beginning to start our journey again. But it is different. Each time it is different. Although the path is the same, the journey is changed because we are changed. Changed by our experiences on the way and by the encounter with the divine. The use of the palm crosses to mark our heads with ash emphasizes the circular nature of our journey. We remember last year's journey. We bring to mind our encounter with the risen Christ, and we prepare ourselves to journey those same well-trod paths, knowing that we have changed over the last year, and we enter into the same story as different people.
ashes to ashes, from dust unto dust. The cross on our forehead, your promise, O God, ready us to follow the way of your Son. To rise from these ashes, redeemed in the fire of your love. Sound the trumpet in Zion, announce from the Lord that the day of God's favor is ever close at hand. Ashes to ashes, from dust unto dust, the cross on our forehead, your promise, O God, ready us to follow the way of your Son. To rise from these ashes, redeemed in the fire of your love. Rend your hearts not, your garments, return to the Lord, who delights when we offer a truly humble heart. Ashes to ashes, from dust unto dust, the cross on our forehead, your promise, O God, ready us to follow the way of your Son. To rise from these ashes, redeemed in the fire of your love. We have seen in the heavens and held in our arms what the hand of our Maker can fashion out of dust. Ashes to ashes, from dust unto dust, the cross on our forehead, your promise, O God, ready us to follow the way of your Son. To rise from these ashes, redeemed in the fire of your love.
So why ash? Well, there are various reasons why we use ash. There are many cases of ashes being used in the Old Testament, such as Daniel chapter 9, verses 3 to 6. It was used as a sign of repentance, a sign to demonstrate to God and to others that we recognize our faults, that we are sorry and want to change and to be changed. It is a recognition of our fallen nature and our longing to become more fully what God intended, imago Dei, made in the image of God. We receive the ashes with the words, "Remember that thou art dust, and unto dust thou shalt return." This is a reminder that as sons of Adam, we are all formed from the dust of creation by God. And this same dust is used by Jesus to heal us. Remember Jesus healing the blind man with mud in John 9:6? It also reminds us that our mortality, that our earthly desires will end. But because Jesus lived as one of us and rose again, so we will live on beyond our earthly life and desires. With COVID restrictions, we can't use ash. So how then will we mark the beginning of our journey this year? This past year has been marred by an absence of human contact and touch. It means that we can't mark our foreheads with ash as we normally would. But marking the beginning of our journey through Lent is an essential part of our faith, a day of obligation for all Christians to mark. So how are we going to do it? Well, this year I'm inviting you to join me in making a St. Bridget cross. This is a simple cross which we can weave. Traditionally, it's made of reeds. You can use anything you have to hand. If you haven't got any reeds or similarly pliable plants in the garden, then cut some strips of paper. Or, like me, you can use pipe cleaners. You'll need 20 to 30 centimeter long lengths, and we'll take you through the simple steps of how to weave your cross now.
So we pick a good thick rod to start with, and we hold it in our left hand. With your right hand, you have to pinch and fold your first weaving rod. Your left hand holds it, and then we turn it through 90 degrees clockwise. Second weaving brush is pinched in the right hand and is placed on top, just above the center. Our left hand holds it and turns it through 90 degrees. Our right hand reaches for another brush, which is pinched and folded and placed on top into the center. Our left hand holds it and turns it through 90 degrees. So as you can see, the right hand is pinching a new rod each time, and the left hand holds what has just been inserted and turns it through 90 degrees. And we continue this process all the way through until you think the bridge's cross is thick enough. I'm getting to the stage now where I've put enough rods on. Each arm has maybe 4 or 5 folded rods. And when you're putting the last rod in, you raise up the rod where the final rush is going to go. You fold it in your right, and you put each end of the last rod under the raised rod. Slide it through, and this raised rod locks everything into position. And there we have the finished bridge's cross. And to finish off the cross, normally the arms are tied. Here I'm just using a bit of string. And because the rushes are freshly cut, they will shrink. So pull the string quite tight. You move around each arm. Arranging the cross in some sort of an order. And there we go. The four arms are tied. And then all that's left is to snip off the ends of each of the arms to give you a nice, neat cross.
So if you're anything like me, you've probably watched that clip quite a number of times as you've been making your Bridget cross, making sure you get those weaves just right. Hopefully, in the end, you'll have something that looks maybe a little bit like this, your very own Bridget cross. So you can take up your cross and follow Jesus on your journey through Lent. But there's more that we can do with our cross. With this cross that we've made now, we can place these seeds into the weeds. You can use any seeds you've got. I've got sweet peas here myself as something that's easy to grow, but you can choose anything you'd like. You can place them in the weave. Now, these seeds are our symbol of our mortality. These words, from dust thou came and to dust thou shalt return. But it's also a symbol of that which we want to leave behind on our journey. These things in our lives that we want to leave behind, we want to change, we let them die. And in that space where we've let those things go, that's where we want these seeds to start to germinate and grow and blossom. God's love growing within us on our journey through Lent, so that we can not just come to the cross, but come to that empty tomb and the joy of Easter. So we place our seeds within the weaves of the cross, and then we can plant them out in the churchyard, or if you can't get to the churchyard, plant them out in your garden. And hopefully by Easter, you'll have a beautiful cross of flowers growing. So do you want to grab some seeds and just place them within the weaves?
That's not fitting in.
Oh, that's going in okay. Well done, madam. So once you've managed to place your seed within the weaves of your cross, you can just come out to the churchyard, or if you can't make it to a churchyard easily with walking, then plant them in your garden. And you can use a stick, or I've got some of these plastic tags, and we can just use them to keep them in place, put them on the earth, and just stake them in place to stop the wind blowing them around. Okay, can I do yours? And then during our Lenten journey, you can come and check. And there's resources on the website if you want to come and pray and examine once a week, check on your crosses and see how it's growing, and reflect on your journey as we approach Holy Week and Easter celebrations. Sovereign Lord, all our beginnings and endings are encompassed by you. Help us to follow in the footsteps of Christ and seek your kingdom with all our hearts. In Jesus, may we find firm footing for our feet and clear direction to our travels, with his life and love breathed into our witness. May we stand with him, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross. Amen.
Lord Jesus, think on me and purge away my sin. From earthborn passion, set me free and make me pure within. Lord Jesus, think on me. Sure.